So this session is on what's next for Kildare. So my name is Paula Rourke and I'm the Climate Action Officer here with Kildare County Council, and I'll be your host for this event. So you're all very welcome, as I said. We're live today, coming from various locations within the County of Kildare via good old Teams. Thank God for technology, we sometimes say, and sometimes we don't. So we're delighted to be, as I said, partaking in this event. It's the first time that we've had a Kildare Climate and Energy Week. And we're delighted to say that not only is Kildare County Council helping us out with this event, but we're also backed by the Sustainable Energy Authority of Ireland, otherwise known as SEAI, Creative Ireland, and several other supporting organisations. So some housekeeping before we start this process is this has been live streamed, so please make sure your mics are turned off. The event will be recorded, so if you don't want your image on screen, please turn off your camera. Note that none of us are seasoned or professional presenters in front of the camera, but we're here to give you our knowledge and expertise in the fields that we're discussing today. So we're going to discuss the latest information and insights to address the questions of the day, and we want to hear from you. So please populate throughout the entire session any questions or comments that you have in the chat function, because we'll have about 30 or 40 minutes towards the end of the session to go through all those questions. So don't be worried. Anything and everything, just put it in there and we'll answer as much as we can. Anything that we don't get answered now, we will answer later and will be put up on our webpage in response to those questions, most likely next week. In worst case scenario, the week after that. Also, all the videos from this week will be on YouTube, and that should help anyone who didn't get a chance to see anything during the week. If you're tweeting, if you happen to be one of those people that like to do that, please use the hashtag time to switch on and tag Kildare County Council. So we all know that in 2019, Ireland proclaimed that we also had a climate crisis and a biodiversity crisis. So it's imperative that we assist nature to repair itself so that we can continue to live on what we know as our lovely blue planet in a harmonious way. So we have to help nature because, believe it or not, it helps us extensively. And anybody that was at this morning's session will know that natural capital is what we borrow constantly, and we are depleting the earth and we need instead to help it. So we all know the earth, if we didn't exist tomorrow morning, it would thrive. But you and me, we wouldn't. So we have to take care of it. Here today, we have people that are looking at the wider picture for what's next for Kildare. And the panelists that we've invited, they're here to discuss ideas and works that they're doing. They're going to progress throughout the county at various scales. These include proposals for the use of Midlands Bogs as a national park, hopefully into the future. This is a vision that is shared by a number of people with background from tourism to conservation. We also will be looking at Maynooth University's Green Campus and the initiative that they have ongoing there and how this supports biodiversity, but also supports climate justice. We'll have a representative from Kildare County Council to give a great insight into the actions being taken in the arena of heritage and biodiversity. And last but not least, we'll also be giving you a lovely look at our fertile lands in this county, and not just our bog lands, as you will hear at the start of the session. So we all know that we have to take care of everything we have, and let's get you introduced now to the panelists. So first and foremost, we have what's known as the National Peatlands Park Group. We'll be joined by four members of that group. We have Lorraine Benson, who is an environmental scientist and coordinator of the National Peatlands Park Group. We have Desmond Harding, who's Ireland's leading butterfly expert and educator, founder, member, director and conservation officer of the Butterfly Conservation Ireland. He's also an author of award-winning book Discovering Irish Butterflies and Their Habitats. So get it out there, folks, and have a good read someday. Tristan White is director of policy at the Irish Peatlands Conservation Council, and Ray Stapleton is the award-winning ecotourism entrepreneur and manager of Lullymore Heritage and Discovery Park. After them, we'll have Dr. Jim Carolyn from Maynooth University. He's a lecturer and researcher at the Department of Biology in there. His research interests include pollinator biology, crop-pest interactions, biodiversity improvement, and reducing our dependency on chemical pesticides, which is all very topical. Dr. Carolyn also has a keen interest in improving sustainability and environmental awareness within the university. And in 2016, he joined the Maynooth Green Campus. He became a coordinator of its working group in 2018 in biodiversity and has recently become the chair of Maynooth Green Campus Committee, a busy man to say the least. Then we have Bridget Laughlin. She is a representative from Kildare County Council. She's our heritage officer with a massive interest in biodiversity, and she's there since 2002. She's passionate about all aspects of the county's heritage that is built, natural, and of course its archaeology. She's completed her Master's in Science in Biodiversity and Land Use Planning. Bridget is particularly interested in how land use plans and policies can influence biodiversity and its protection, conservation and enhancement. She's also interested in mainstreaming any appreciation of Kildare's natural heritage around all functions of the council. She's a great woman for making sure that we're all doing what we're meant to be doing with regard to that remit. And prior to working in heritage, Bridget also worked as an agricultural advisor, so she knows what she's talking about on the land. And she's also, thankfully, a member of the Kildare County Council's Climate Action Team. And then, last but least, we're going to have Kim and Mireille McCall, who are going to give us an in-depth look at their farm in Calverstown, a delightful place. So Kim is a healthy mix of a farmer, ecologist, landscaper, bioculturist, forester, historian. I could go on, he's a land lover. And by his side is Mireille, the lady with the gift to see beauty in everything that surrounds her, and a combined love for nature and making the most of the bounty that the land provides. The farming practices what they consider to be right, but for many that would go against the grain of the conventional farmer. But they are achieving results that others would be envious of, to their working with nature and thinking outside the box. So given their passion and grow for nature in all its forms, alongside farming, this couple were accepted into the National Biodiversity Data Centre's Protecting Farmland Pollinators under the European Innovation Partnership, otherwise known as EIP. So the McCalls invited myself and Kira onto their land to have a wonderful look at what they're doing for a talk and walk, and we threw our wellies into the boot and we arrived. We ended up spending 3 hours there, we had a great time, and just for everybody, because we did video this outside, there was a little bit of wind interference, so once the music stops, please increase your volume so that you can make sure that you hear everything that has to be said, because it's very, very worthwhile. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to our first ones, as I have, but we want to ask, could the National Peatlands Parks people please start their presentation? Thank you.
Well, Paula, after that introduction, we are absolutely delighted to be sharing our view on the National Peatlands Park, particularly this week as we go into COP26 in Glasgow. The whole world is heading to Glasgow, but we're having our own mini COP26 here in Kildare. So I'd like to congratulate yourself, Paula, and Kira, and all the team for the amazing lineup and selection of events and speakers that you arrange for this week. So
thank you, Lorraine. Sorry, your screen hasn't gone to full. If you can, maybe up the size of it if possible.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, I wonder is that, can you see a full screen now?
No.
Nope. Don't worry. Keep going. Maybe if you can start, see how it works out. If everybody's comfortable with it, we'll continue. Is that okay?
Okay. Can everybody sort of see my screen?
Yeah.
I hope it's not too small, but sorry about that. I thought I was on full screen. So what we're going to talk about here, just to give you a quick overview, we want to give you a sense of our vision for a National Peatlands Park, primarily in County Kildare. We're going to show you our plan and a map. After I speak, Tris is going to follow up and describe the Bog of Allen, and then Jesmond will give you an indication of the existing biodiversity in the Kildare Bogs. Ray will then talk about ecotourism. And finally, we'll leave you with some images of the bog wildlife, which Tina Claffey, the wildlife photographer, has agreed to share with us. So this is our vision. Let's get straight into it. Our group aims to establish a new National Peatlands Park on a landscape scale, and that's very important, in the Bog of Allen in County Kildare and in the east part of County Offaly, with a view to rewild and restore the cutaway peatlands following the cessation of industrial scale peat extraction. And as Paula has already stated, we're facing a climate and biodiversity emergency. So we see this National Peatlands Park as being part of the solution in how we're going to address this national emergency. We feel that this will, the establishment of the Peatlands Park will increase biodiversity. It will create space for nature to recover. It will help mitigate climate change. It will help capture and store carbon. It will improve water quality, water storage, and prevent flooding. It will safeguard our peatland heritage for science, archaeology, education, and research. And it will enhance the social and economic life of our communities. So this is who we are. We are supported by national and local conservation and environmental and community groups. At national level, we have the Irish Peatland Conservation Council, Birdwatch Ireland, Butterfly Conservation Ireland, and on the lower level, not the lower level because they're just as important, all our local conservation groups and community groups are supporting us. And there are many, many more who have joined us since we started our campaign. So why a national park? Well, just have a look at this map. On the western seaboard, you see all our national parks, well, most of them. We've only got one in the east coast, and that's Wicklow National Park. And what's glaringly absent there is the entire Midlands, where we have a heritage of raised bogs, and there isn't any national park there to mark their importance or celebrate their heritage. So what we did was we had a look at County Kildare and we selected this area, which is our proposed area of interest, and we put together this concept map. And you can see why we've chosen this area. In the north, you have the Royal Canal Greenway. We have the Blue Way towards the south. And in the centre, you have all our excavated bogs, which are now barren and without any purpose. And in the centre, we also have a nucleus of conservation and ecotourism infrastructure, green infrastructure. We have the Irish Peatland Conservation Council headquarters. We have Butterfly Conservation Ireland, who manage a series of reserves here in this area. And we have Ray's Lullymore Heritage and Discovery Park, providing important ecotourism infrastructure for that area. So you can see the whole area knits very well in terms of existing infrastructure that we have for celebrating our conservation and a number of other areas such as Donaghadee Forest Park. It's not just about bogs, it's about the entire area. So just moving a little bit deeper, look what is behind our map. Now this is a satellite photograph of the area that we're talking about. And while it's very difficult to see on a small screen, you'd need a very large screen to see this. But here we have 30 different areas of high nature value dotted around the mapped area. And what is interesting is that these areas, these little dots are fragile, and unless they are protected and restored, we may lose them altogether. So our map aims to, and our project aims to, protect and restore all of these areas and to revitalize and restore the bogland surrounding them. We all know that bogs, and as Mark McCurry, I was listening to Mark this morning, and as he said, CO2 leaches from the bogs once they are dug up and left bare. So it is our moral obligation to make sure that our bogs are not left as bare peat. And let me show you what we're looking at the moment. This is the bare peat of North Kildare. And this is another picture of what it's looking like. And metre for metre, those bogs left untouched and uncovered are just leaking carbon dioxide and methane into the atmosphere. Look at this picture. I think most of us would prefer something that looked like a bit like that. So let me go back to what to summarise what we hope to achieve with this project. We want a new relationship with our with our peatland heritage. We want to build national and international recognition. Already our bogs are the envy of many in Europe and around the world. We want to create a network of interconnected areas of high nature value, connecting those dots. And we want to develop our existing tourism infrastructure and create new peatland related experiences. And in this way, change perceptions and empower our local communities. Now, I think I'll pass over to Tris, if you wouldn't mind, Tris, talking about the Bog of Allen. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Lorraine. The Bog of Allen. So the peatland habitats in Kildare form part of the wider Bog of Allen, which once spread around 115,000 hectares with a large present in County Kildare. The Bog of Allen wasn't a single large raised bog, but a connected array of smaller complexes, such as the Biodiversity Bog Group, which is the largest such complex within the Bog of Allen. And as the bog started to form around 10,000 years ago in the glacial lakes of the Midlands, they grew above the surrounding landscape and joined together, creating a unique mosaic of raised bog and fen habitats, sequestering carbon, regulating climate, and providing habitat for many specialised peatland species. But as the Biodiversity Bog Group was the largest complex, it was also the first to be industrially exploited, changing the landscape forever. This industrial exploitation spread across the whole Bog of Allen, and now we are faced with the realisation that only 10% of the original extent is left. This is a crucial factor in the climate and biodiversity emergency that the government declared in 2019. But now, as the government is moving to a zero carbon economy, lots of peatland is coming out of production, and there is the potential to not only repair the ecological function of the county's landscape, but also put the peatland forefront in the county's identity. The next slide, please, Lorraine. Is that coming across? Ah, here we go, the two photos. Yep, so as I was talking about the potential, and before I pass here to Dr. Jesmond, I'd like to show that this site was a bare cutaway in 2013, but now is regenerating under the management of the Lunnymore Heritage and Discovery Park. In 2018, this was the location of the once thought to be extinct moth, the suspected, was recorded, highlighting the importance that these once industrial landscapes are going to be key in the metamorphosis of our economy into one which is sustainable and circular, and peatland should be a focal point within that. Thank you so much, and I'll pass you on to Dr. Jesmond.
Thank you very much, Tris, and delighted to have the opportunity to talk to everyone about this fabulous proposal we have. Now, this is a photograph of a brimstone butterfly. The brimstone, you can see it's a beautiful male backlit specimen with the sun shining through its golden wings. Every national park has a symbol. So in Killarney, we have the arbutus, the strawberry tree. In the Burren, we have the Gentiana verna, the blue gentian. I'm proposing this idea of the brimstone butterfly with its sense of optimism and brightness as a symbol for the National Park for County Kildare. Lorraine, next slide, please. Now, what we've done is we've just taken two animal groups to highlight the importance of the area for nature and biodiversity in general. So the two groups we've taken are butterflies and birds. So we start with the birds of conservation concern in Ireland from 2020-2026. The amber-listed birds of conservation concern occurring in the Ballydermot Bog Group region are the hen harrier, goshawk, kingfisher, merlin, skylark, swallow, sand martin, willow warbler, spotted flycatcher, goldcrest, greenfinch, linnet, whooper swan, mallard duck, and teal. And that is 15 species, which is actually 19% of Ireland's amber listed species, and happily I've actually seen all of those species on the bog. Next slide, please. The red listed birds, which are the birds of high conservation concern occurring in the Ballydermot Bog Group region, are swift, woodcock, kestrel, meadow pipit, grey wagtail, yellowhammer, redwing, lapwing, curlew, snipe, which comes to 10 species, which is 18% of our red listed species. So again, the area is very, very important for bird life, in particular birds that are rapidly disappearing in other places. And here we have some examples here. This is the hen harrier, beautiful bird of prey, very common there over the winter. We have lapwing, very in a lot of trouble on our farmed landscapes. If we go to the next slide, we will see the curlew, again, in really, really serious difficulty, down to well below 200 breeding pairs left. And the last survey was done in 2015, when it was 138 breeding pairs. It could be even worse at this point, and they're just clinging on the Ballydermot Bog Group. Now, looking at bog flora and invertebrates, the place is a riot of insect activity and colour over the summer. And I'm going to start looking at that in a bit of more detail. So next slide, please, Lorraine. Now, species richness at Ballydermot. Studies indicate that butterfly species and their population abundance serve as an indicator of the range and quality of habitat types. According to a report published by the Dutch Ministry of Agriculture in 2003, the Ballydermot region is one of the three important butterfly areas in Ireland, IBAs. And while I'm just mentioning that, it's rather telling that it was someone from the Netherlands who reported on that, not someone from our country. So we really need to recognise what we have and the importance of what we have, and not just, you know, relying on people abroad to let us know what we've got. Next slide, please, Lorraine. Now, this is a photograph of a beautiful flower, the bee orchid, and we have that on the Ballydermot Bog Group, especially on the marl, bare marl areas, a beautiful flower, and sometimes we get there are colonies of them, and really make a spectacular sight, just an indication of the biodiversity of the area. Next slide, please. Now, in the second information text slide for species richness at Ballydermot, four of the six most threatened Irish butterflies breed here. Butterfly Conservation Ireland recorded 26 of Ireland's 35 butterfly species here between 1995 and 2021. The region contains a remarkable moth population, including endangered or near threatened species, such as the forester moth, which is endangered, narrow bordered five spot burnet, which is ranked vulnerable, small purple barred, wood tiger, and small chocolate tip, which is near threatened. And a species considered extinct by the National Parks and Wildlife Service in 2016, the suspected, was first found at Lullymore in 2018 and has been found every year since then. So the area may contain more apparently missing species than we're aware of at the moment. Next slide, please. Now, I'm going to give you a little bit of detail about some of the very important species that occur there. This is a large heath butterfly. And while it's probably not going to sell too many t-shirts, it's not a particularly glamorous species, it's a very important species, a really great indicator of the health of a peatland. The large heath is ranked vulnerable on the Red List of Irish Butterflies. The large heath is ranked vulnerable on the European Red List. There is an urgent need to conserve and restore remaining bogs and desist from further destruction of bogs to halt the disappearance of this iconic bog butterfly. And one of the most renowned people in Europe in terms of butterfly conservation is the Professor of Ecology at the University of Oxford, Jeremy Thomas, who said, "No one doubts that the widespread loss of peatlands in Ireland is causing numerous local extinctions in the species stronghold, and is a very great cause for concern." And he made that statement in his book in 2014. Next slide, please. This is a marsh artillery, fabulous, beautiful, really enchanting species. And I would encourage anybody to have a look at that in the wild. Photographs don't do it justice. It really is stunning. And you have to look carefully at it because it's a small butterfly, but it's really rewarding when you get up close and personal. And this species will sit and bask and allow you to approach it closely. So well worth looking at. Next slide, please. The marsh tillery is ranked vulnerable on the Red List of Irish Butterflies. The marsh tillery is declining throughout Europe and is placed on the Annex 2 list under the EU Habitats Directive in 1992. This requires the member governments of the European Union to designate special areas of conservation for this species. In the Ballydermot region, two long-term monitored populations are known, along with outlying populations. It continues to thrive in these areas, but it has become extinct on sites that have actually been designated for it as special areas of conservation. So it's thriving in the area we're concerned with, and those habitats are well managed by Butterfly Conservation Ireland and the Irish Peatland Conservation Council. Next slide, please. Now, the next slide you are looking at is the wall brown. That's a male specimen there, is basking on a bit of limestone. And the text slide is next. The wall brown status in the Red List of Irish Butterflies 2010 is endangered, so it's in really serious trouble in Ireland. The wall brown may be extinct in Northern Ireland, where it was last seen in 2015, and incidentally one was seen this August in County Down. So one, since between 2015 and 2021, one single specimen was seen in part of Ireland that used to be common. The wall brown still breeds in the Ballydermot region, but this once common species is at risk of extinction. Further habitat change may see it lost from the area and probably from the county. Next slide, please. Now, habitat richness at Ballydermot. Now, I talked about the species richness. Well, species rely on habitats and the quality of those habitats. The main habitats that exist in the area are bog, grassland, scrub, mixed and deciduous woodland, marsh and open water habitats such as flooded, cutover bog and rivers. This has resulted in a stunning landscape. In some areas, habitats exist in proximity, creating habitat mosaics with high biodiversity value, especially for invertebrates. Rare plants like the green-winged orchid and basil thyme exist in the region. Scientific studies have been undertaken in the area, and there is considerable scope for further study applying the Irish vegetation classification. Ballydermot is one of the few places where you can see wildlife that used to be everywhere in the wider countryside during our childhoods, where clouds of butterflies are still found, where grasshoppers still sing and cuckoos call. We cannot take these wildlife Edens for granted. Next slide. There's a photograph of conservation grazing on Lullybeg Reserve. That is managed for butterflies, and grazing is a main conservation tool that's applied to maintain high quality grassland habitats. So if we go to the next slide, I'm going to describe this in a bit more detail. Partnership with the farming community. Wildlife habitats need management to protect their high nature value, with cattle grazing the main conservation tool used. Butterfly Conservation Ireland has partnered with a local farmer to graze the reserve at Lullybeg. This protects the habitats and provides the farmer with additional grazing, including late autumn, where poaching is a concern in agricultural grassland, but is welcome on wild grasslands, creating a diverse vegetation structure and avoiding a closed sward, allowing for germination of flora. There's considerable scope to extend this practice on a future national park where grazing is essential. And thank you very much for listening to me, and I'm going to pass you on. But before I do, there's a slide here which shows the wonder of peatlands, even in the depths of winter. Look at the wildfowl on that site with the duck and the geese and swan populations. Something there for people to look at and admire at any time of the year. And I think I'm passing you on to Ray at this point. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks, Jesmond, and hello to everyone, and thanks to Kildare County Council for organising this event today. I'm delighted to represent Lullymore Heritage Park, and you know, and my colleagues as well, to work alongside my colleagues in all the organisations, as you can see there, the Peatlands Conservation Council, Jesmond and everyone else. Really, in Lullymore, I'm just part of a bigger team, past and present, that have attracted quite a bit of tourism to Lullymore that just we didn't have 25 years ago. And it's brought jobs, and it's brought a newfound confidence to the people of this area. So next slide, please, Lorraine. Yeah. And just firstly, it's the right time and place to be talking about our bogs, their rewilding and our reconnection with them. My brief talk on the potential of tourism will show that collaboration is important. We all have different expertise, and I think that by working together and with science communities and the bogs at the heart of what we do and why we do it, a National Peatlands Park is possible, and it will be a real jewel in the crown of Ireland's landscape. Tourism Ireland always states that people choose Ireland above other countries when they decide to come here because of our people, our landscape, our heritage and our culture. Sustainable and green tourism is growing rapidly here and internationally, and this is set to continue, certainly in stronger than ever in a post-COVID world. The communities of the Midlands have not traditionally benefited from tourism revenue as much as other regions, and this was partly due to the industrialisation of our peatlands. We believe in Peatlands National Park, or linked national parks across the Midlands, have the potential to protect both the bogs and the peatland communities living around them. Common experiences of national park regions in America and in the North, USA and the UK show that there's less unemployment, more entrepreneurs, the profile of the region is raised, and it's a great long-term way to protect the habitat. If we can rehabilitate and restore our peatlands as best we can on a large scale, they will become truly wild places and can be showcased as superheroes of ecosystems. I've witnessed the rewilding of the cutways on the Peatlands Biodiversity Area in Lullymore Heritage Park. That's a picture of the bog cotton on it. And it has been the most rewarding part of my work in Lullymore over the last 25 years. The picture of the motorway sign is important, and a big thanks to Photoshop for that, because it doesn't exist yet, but we're really hoping it will soon. And if the nuts and bolts were tightened on that sign, it'd be an empowering moment for people in the Midlands. Within a short time, nearly every tourism and hospitality business in the area would include located in Ireland's National Peatlands Park. From an international visitor's point of view, it would be a sign to show that Ireland has moved from being a nation that neglected and industrialised its peatland landscape to a country that protects and cherishes it. It will also change perceptions domestically and, I believe, inspire local communities to embrace new possibilities. Next slide, please, Lorraine. And as a venue for different types of tourist related activity, it's a great location. The Bog of Allen is located just 1 hour's drive from Dublin, but it's a world away in escaping the hustle and bustle of the city. That's a population of 2.5 million people, if you include counties surrounding Kildare, within easy distance for day trips where reasons to visit could include anything from leisurely rambles, serious hikes, family days out, water-based activities, cycling, visiting attractions for culture, education and fun, restaurants, cafes, or simply just to escape to a wild place. Then add millions of potential international visitors arriving in Dublin Airport annually. I think in 2019 it was close to 10 million. And they're looking to explore our landscape, people and history. Any potential National Peatlands Park isn't starting out without a tourism infrastructure. The area we have highlighted contains a variety of key destinations in Ireland's ancient east, and the story of the peatlands is already told in established businesses like ours and the Irish Peatland Conservation Council. There's also really exciting new local developments like the Barrow Blueway, Umeris Peatlands Park, and even Bono's Distillery in Kildare, in just outside Monastrevin. So this is what will make this national park so special. It'll be a celebration of our landscape and reflect the Irish people's ability to change. It will also be a biodiversity project and an environmental research site on a scale which may well be unmatched across Europe, and one which will evolve and get more special as each year passes. I think this picture symbolises a lot of what we've already discussed, and we understand and respect our past, but it is time for change and to reconnect with our wild peatlands. They have protected and sustained our ancestors in the past, and the decisions made by government and Bord na Mána in the near future are so important. Let's hope and do all that we can to ensure that these decisions, which will protect our peatlands, as they just might protect us and next generation too. So thanks everyone, and over to you, I think, Lorraine.
Ray, thank you very much indeed. And we're coming to a close now, but we'd just like to leave you with a few images which the wildlife photographer Tina Claffey has allowed us to share with you. Tris, I don't know whether you're still there.
Yeah, I'm still here.
Great. So
this is a lovely round-leaved sundew from Tina Claffey. I'm not sure what bog this was taken on, but you can find it all over the bogs around the Midlands. The red tame tentacles are absolutely great for sticking to little, and then over a couple of days they will digest the fly slowly. And just on a side note, with the sundew, there's actually an old tradition, it occurs in the Netherlands as well, where the proteins or the enzymes in the carnivorous plant actually breaks down the proteins in milk. So someone a long time ago realized that if you throw these carnivorous plants into milk, it would actually turn it to sour milk, and then you would use that for your sourdough or your soda bread. So lovely photograph there. Next slide, please, Elaine. This is the lovely raft spider carrying some eggs there, and they're very class spiders. You know, they get very, I think it's Ireland's largest spider, but they will actually dive under the water and take fish, and they actually feel the surface of the water for the vibrations. Very class. Next slide, please, Elaine. And the marsh retiree, of course, IPCC manage Lullymore West for the marsh retiree. It's Ireland's only, you know, legally designated protected species. You know, really important that we manage these. And also by the fact Jasmine was saying that they disappear from the SACs, and they're with, that's under management as well, you know, so it's kind of a fine line in managing them. We're always constantly assessing the habitat to make sure that it's providing for them. Everyone should go and see them. The next slide, please, Lorraine. The four-spotted chaser. These can be seen, I think, up to about 2 weeks ago, all across Ballydermot. Any drain or any bog pool that you know, it's very possible that you might find a four-spotted chaser. They're quite, you know, they're quite big. Amazing to think that they actually spend two to three years underwater as a little larvae, attacking fish and insects before deciding, you know, it's time for them to emerge as a dragonfly. So if you can get out and see them too, they're absolutely amazing. And the next slide, please, Lorraine. And of course, the bouquet of sphagnum moss, the main bog building plant, very slow growing, one millimeter a year on average. But also that photo, you know, you kind of get a sheen off of it. And that's, I think that is, a parameter of the hyaline cells, which are able to hold to something like 90% of their weight in water, and it makes it very strong, so, you know, so they can hold on to the water during the real wet periods, but when it gets dry, they're still wet as well, still wet still. It's a very important, one of the main bog building plants. And the next slide, please, Lorraine. And this is, of course, the bog snorkeler, or bog cotton, has. And this one is, that is Fluorocheina, the matchstick lichen. Amazing in the fact that it's actually a symbiosis between algae and mushroom. So, you know, they've evolved to live together. So the mushroom grows and gives it structure and allows more surface area for the algae to actually photosynthesize. And don't forget, bogs are nutrient poor, which is why you have the carnivorous plants on there as well. So they, you know, they evolve to live together to actually provide themselves with nutrients, and they share the nutrients between them. Very interesting. There's lots of different types of lichens on the bog, and the bog snorkeler. Here we go, bog cotton. Very important in the bog. You know, it's all species on the bog are specialized. And one of the things with bog cotton is it has the parenchyma, which is like a straw which runs down the center of the main plant of the bog, and it allows oxygen to get into the roots in the real wet saturated conditions. It's lovely to see. And when a bog is regenerating there, you'll often see you know, fields of bog cotton, which are iconic as well. So thank you very much. And I think we're just finishing off with a poem, and Lorraine's going to press play. Not sure I'm hearing that.
Hi, Lorraine. So you might have to share your screen, but share with sound for us to hear.
Oh, dear. I'm so sorry. No, we have to keep this for another day. I think we may have run over time.
Maybe we could share it to the County Kildare website, maybe?
Possibly.
That's yes. Perfect. Yeah.
Yeah.
We can do that.
Okay, so that concludes our presentation for today. We hope you enjoyed it. Thank you for listening, and even with the small screen. And we look forward to your support and any questions later on.
Lorraine and co, thank you so, so much for that wonderful presentation and the images that you portrayed there. Just remember, anybody's got a hand up, can you please put your comments in the Q&A section there, and we'll ask them at the end, if that's okay. So next we have Dr. Jim Carlin from Maynooth University, who's going to present us information on the Green University Scheme. Thank you, Jim.
Thanks, Paula. So can you hear me okay? Yep, great. So again, before I begin, I just want to thank the organisers of this event for inviting me along today to talk about the Maynooth Green Campus, and particularly some of the biodiversity initiatives that we've been involved in over the past 3 or 4 years particularly. But before I begin, I just want to commend Kildare County Council and the organisers for actually putting on this event. It's been fantastic, the bits I've tuned into already. And what you're getting a sense is that everybody is really aware of the crises that we're now facing, whether it be climate crises, biodiversity loss, our pollution of our environment. And we need to move from a period of discussion to one of acceptance and actions. And I think by gathering people that like this with diverse experience, diverse expertise and opinion, we get the discussions going, we get those actions going. And what we need to do is be a little bit more brave in terms of what we're doing, because we need to put these actions in place. And again, I just want to say it's events like this that really get those discussions going. So I'm delighted to be part of it. So in terms of what I'm here to do is to just talk a little bit about the Maynooth Green Campus. So what we are is we are a voluntary body of about 50 individuals who are staff, students, members of the wider community. And we essentially look at trying to improve sustainability and environmentalism within the campus population, but also on the grounds around us as well. So the Green Campus was established back in 2011. And initially what we were looking at was the effect that the educational and green spaces had on the individuals within the university. But it became quite clear that our focus was wrong, and we changed our remit almost after a year to look at how we actually impacted our environments around us. So essentially what we did is we set up a number of working groups in a few different areas, and we had people that had various expertise and that could lead these groups. And we started looking for projects and initiatives that would really improve sustainability within the student body, the staff within Maynooth, and obviously the town around us as well. And we're a very unique campus in terms of we have the Maynooth University, but we also have the seminary. So this is St. Patrick's College, Maynooth, and we have the offices of Trokera. So the Maynooth Green Campus is built on that triumvirate platform, if you like, of people coming with, as I said, diverse views and experiences to really look at improving sustainability and environmentalism within our communities. We have a strong connection with the Maynooth town as well. So we have members of the Maynooth Tidy Towns, for example, who would be on our committee. And again, this brings us even additional expertise and different experiences that we draw on. So it really is a fantastic body that connects people with ideas and tries to put those ideas into action. The Green Campus itself is part of Ontashka's program. So Ontashka are obviously our NGO responsible for a sort of environment and built heritage in Ireland. And they have this Green Campus awards and these Green Campus structures that are affiliated with the Foundation for Environmental Education in Sweden. And what they do is they, again, assess your campus under a number of different headings, and you can apply for a Green Campus status and awards under these. And the actual headings we have initially were these first five. So you have biodiversity, energy, transport, water and waste. And as I said, when we started the Green Campus, we had individuals that took leadership of these groups and then people who wanted to work within these areas. So, for example, I was one of the first coordinators of the biodiversity group because I had research interest in this area. And then we established a biodiversity working group and we started putting plans in place. But we had people who were experts in energy, transport, water and waste that basically led their groups. And these groups all happened organically. This wasn't sort of a directive from the university coming down. It was bottom up. It was community led. And we've kept that spirit and ethos throughout. And I think that's really, really important for us to keep, that it's voluntary, but it's about people wanting to do better. And that's what we all need to be doing these days, is to do better, just even if it's something small, that we make the changes, we get people involved and we show how these changes are working. We find the evidence, we promote this, we publicize it, and then more people want to do these things. So this is essentially the structures that we set the Maynooth Green Campus up. We also have considerable expertise in this area of climate justice, and I know that not many people are familiar with this theme as such. And what climate justice really is, it's about acknowledging that those in society that probably contribute less to damaging our climate are going to be affected more. So there's no equity there. So if you think about sort of, you know, people in maybe in third world countries that have very little industry, they're not sort of contributing carbon to the environment. But again, when climate change happens, it's going to disproportionately affect them. So what climate justice is, it's built on social justice, and it's looking at trying to offset that damage by, first of all, acknowledging it and studying it. So basically, it's very firmly centered on the polluter pays, that those that are causing the damage need to do more work about it. And we also then need to work to protect those that it's going to affect more. So we had this sixth working group, and actually since then we've established some more. So we have one on well-being. So again, how we use our green and blue spaces. So we've now a working group on that. And one of our more recently established ones are sustainable food and agriculture. So, and again, I'll talk a little bit about these. So again, this is just giving you an idea of the themes of the Green Campus itself. So in 2018, we applied for our Green Campus Award under those five themes, but we also requested whether we could actually apply under climate justice as well. And we actually got the award for all six themes. So this was the first university campus and beyond that actually won a green flag in all themes. So again, we really were pioneering and setting the field. And since then, Ontashke have actually adopted climate justice as a new theme that all campuses have to apply for or can apply for under the Green Flags Awards. So I'm not going to go through this in too much detail, but what I wanted to show was, again, how the Green Campus is embedded within the university structures and beyond, because all these connections, they occurred organically. They were just we were a small group once that just started making connections throughout the university. But now you can see how those connections are. We're linked, for example, to our campus life and academic councils. So essentially, in terms of planning and the campus estates, again, Maynooth Green Campus is now consulted, and members of those offices are actually part of the Maynooth Green Campus. OK, and that's a key thing. So if you have someone who's responsible for energy, for example, in the university, well, their job is to basically reduce our energy output, to retrofit boilers, to put up solar panels, to change all our lighting to LED. That's essentially their job. But they also then joined the Maynooth Green Campus. So now they have a forum and a support group where they're able to come and say, well, in addition to me just doing my job, look at what we're doing. So over the past 8 years, we've reduced our energy outputs by 33%. So on a year-on-year, you see this reduction. So as I said, this might be one guy's job, but within the Green Campus, he gets heralded as a hero. So that type of support just essentially promotes activism, promotes you wanting to do things. We also have, as I said, links outside the campus to the Tidy Towns group, to various companies. We've even some projects going, or some of us have projects going with Kildare County Council themselves, looking at biodiversity, for example, in our open public parks. We links to learning are really key. We see ourselves as an organization that are trying to train and develop our next generation of eco-citizens. So obviously within university, we're trying to get our student body completely aware of the issues that we face and to basically start promoting environmentalism within them. This takes no work, because this generation is so tuned in to environmentalism. you know, much more than any generation before them, because I think they realized they are the ones inheriting the world and they really want to do better. So they're coming to us saying, well, where are the sustainability goals embedded in my education, in my modules that I'm taking? You know, what are the events I can get involved in to do more? So again, we always think about how we can make connections to lecturers, to modules, to talk about sustainability, to even generate projects that students can get involved in as on a research level even. So this is something we're keen to always do. And then we link into our student societies as well as that. So that's just giving you, as I said, an idea of the structure of the Green Campus. And all across our themes, we've made massive achievements over the past 5-6 years. And I counted these up a couple of weeks ago, that we've over 50 initiatives that have essentially that we've done that have actually sort of made some benefit or made progress. And these initiatives all start with someone with an idea. And that idea may be that something they've had for a while, saying, well, look, can we actually mow a bit less? Can we reduce glyphosate use on campus? Can we do better in terms of recycling and dividing out our waste? And essentially, that might be something that you'd see, you'd find a can in a normal bin and it'd just annoy you. But now through the Green Campus, you can bring that to us and we say, well, what can we do about this? So we start to develop programs, initiatives, and actually get these things done. And all of these, I'm not going to go through them, we've made massive and significant gains. Okay, now obviously a lot of them got hit hard during COVID, and particularly coming back out of COVID, people are taking the eye off the ball. But it's again, as a community, we will try to sort of get that all focused again. But what I wanted to do for the rest of the talk was just talk a little bit more about, you know, so this idea of connecting individuals with ideas and then sort of looking at some of the initiatives, particularly in the ones in biodiversity. This is another idea that was you know, someone had. So Doreena Bishop, who heads, she's the secretary of the group, but she also heads the waste theme. And one of the things we were doing was we were recycling computers. And what happens during normal times, or normally, is that those computers are broken up and then all those parts get recycled. And Doreena was a bit annoyed by this, saying, well, look, these are perfectly fine computers. Can we not keep them whole and just, you know, wipe them, get them sort of packaged out, and you don't have any waste from them? So the computer can be used by a school or sent abroad and used for educational purposes. So again, working with our IT service, she got this up and running, and basically they now take all our old computers, and instead of breaking them down, they wipe them clean and they get sent out whole. And again, that's a classic example of the types of things we do within the Green Campus. It's someone's idea, and essentially we get support for them and we work on it. This is another fantastic project that I'll mention, which was developed by our Sustainable Food and Agriculture group. And this is a group led by Dr. Patricia Healy Kettle. And she had this idea 16 years ago, in that we have between some of her buildings, these really dead looking areas. And she wanted to develop this area into an edible garden. So this is her area of research. She did this as part of her PhD. And it was only when we connected as a group that she was able to get in touch with the head groundkeeper of the university and then get the support and a bit of funding to get this up and running. And now we have this beautiful edible garden there that she's actually doing research in. So students come over. There's lots of vegetables, heritage apple trees and everything there. And again, she's using that as a green space to look at how it has an effect on our mental well-being as well. Like, you know, so again, anywhere we can do something in Maynooth, once we get away with it, we'll try it. Okay, and that then brings me to the biodiversity group itself. So this was, as I said, a group that I did coordinate, but it's coordinated by someone else now. I'll talk to you about them. And again, we had key aims. We wanted to develop biodiverse areas, create species databases, promote biodiversity on the campus, prep or generate habitat maps, and then get involved in outreach programs, and of course, adopt the All-Ireland Pollinator Plan. And the chap here on the right is really the champion of biodiversity on our campus, and that's Stephen Seaman. So he's the chair or the coordinator of the biodiversity group. He's also our head's groundskeeper. And regardless of what happened with the All-Ireland Pollinator Plan over the past couple of years, I think our campus would still look the same, because he has this just firm belief in biodiversity and trying to allow nature rewild wherever he can. Now, obviously, this is going to, you know, get a bit of pushback, because you're probably very aware that some of the areas in Maynooth campus are absolutely fantastic. from a landscape point of view. So again, it was all about doing small little projects and getting acceptance and then moving on. So you can see the type of areas that we have on the campus. We've got 180 acres that basically Stephen and his team are responsible for. But already about 10% of that are actually managed for biodiversity. So I think he estimated that 1 million square foot of our campus, both St. Patrick's and Maynooth University, are now given over to biodiversity. And if you look at our grounds there, you can, you know, they're quite diverse. We have these beautiful landscaped areas, you know, these almost natural works of art. So these are yew trees, you know, so a beautiful avenue of them. Again, lots of the areas on the campus, they just look so natural. OK, so there's very little sort of, you know, cultivation or management of the trees, for example. We just let them sort of grow as they are, within reason, obviously. But then we also have sort of semi-natural habitats that we also try to protect and again utilize within the university. So as a group, we're members of the All-Ireland Pollinator Plan, obviously, so Maynooth University is, and we've adopted a lot of their practices. We've identified numerous sites across the campus. We call it the 10 Sites Project. And again, what we do each year is we look at what plants are growing, what new ones that we have, and actually we do a lot of work on insects as well in terms of biodiversity for pollinators. So again, one of the main practices that you're all pretty familiar with are, you know, don't mow, let it grow type approaches. So again, lots of the areas that we have on the campus now are under management like this. So again, we just basically identify an area, we'd let it grow, maybe give it a cut at the end of the year, maybe a path throughout, a stick up a sign and let it do its thing. Okay, so again, this is one of our small meadows called the Calla Meadow, which is now underneath new building at the minute. But again, you can see sort of types of things that we do. And even with this, this was our very first meadow that we had on the campus maybe 4 or 5 years ago. And within like months, you were seeing a transformation. And this was before it was very widely accepted that these types of things should be done. So even in terms of the university community, a lot of people were quite annoyed by how these things were looking. But again, once you stick up a sign and you give the impression that things are under management, acceptance and perception start to change. And again, that was mentioned in the earlier talks as well, that this is what this is all about. It's about changing people's attitudes, their behaviors, their perceptions. So over the course of a year or two, we've had sort of, you know, fantastic flora and fauna in these areas. We use these areas for education purposes, but also for, you know, connecting members of the community. So we organize walks around these areas so that they're viewed and all. So again, I think this is a really important thing to actually immerse people in the green spaces. You need to actually physically put them out there to promote that type of behavior. And again, I'll just flick through these. So all these before and after shots. So the junior garden, this is Lyrene Walk. So again, a couple of years ago, you would have looked at this as just being unkempt and untidy, but we don't see it that way. We see it's a value. So you have willow on the right hand side. That's an early flowering plant. So again, your queen bumblebees coming out of hibernation will need pollen and forage in early February. So a lot of solitary bees as well would feed on the flowers of willow. You have the bramble and over on the left here. So again, this was in flower in the summer. So you have a nice area. And actually these tufts of grass, we'd have bumblebee queens hibernating in these areas. So again, our approach is basically cut a path so we've access. And again, get people in there to actually sort of immerse themselves in and view it. Where we find, yeah, so again, like that. And then when we find we have areas, again, Stephen will come up with pollinator plans. So again, we'd have ornamental plants. We try to stick as native as possible. But again, these areas transform into sort of beautiful little pockets of biodiversity. So again, wherever you find some space. And then you have sort of bigger and more ambitious types of transformations. So for example, these were new apartments. But because the Green Campus was working with the university in a very sort of organic, dynamic way, when we get new builds, members of the campus are actually now consulted. So it's much better to be involved in planning at the beginning than doing it retrospectively a couple of years later. So for example, Stephen would have advised on sort of what to plant around these new buildings, what to put up on the green roofs. So again, it's just a fantastic interaction we now have with the university. So areas like that look now like this. And in some of these areas we'll lose, because the college has to sort of evolve. So this particular area, we're now going to lose to an outdoor sports park, if you like, you know, the ones with all the equipment, so people can sort of do more training outside. But that's fine, because again, what we'll get then is some another area from the university to basically give over to wildflowers. So why I mention that is sometimes we have to be very pragmatic and work with our institutions to try and, you know, get these types of initiatives up and running first. So you win some, you lose some, but what we're finding is we're winning more. So as I said, we have almost 15 acres of land on the campus now given over to biodiversity. In 2019 and 20, we won a green flag for parks. So again, we were the first university campus to win this award. And we also got awarded the overall prize for the All-Ireland Pollinator Plan in 2020 also. So again, I think this is just fantastic recognition of the work we're doing in biodiversity, and particularly Stephen and his team. So, sorry, I'm having a bit of an issue getting onto the next slide. Again, what I'm just showing you here are some ideas we have for a virtual map, so a biodiversity map that we're developing. But again, I know I'm talking and yapping on too long, so I'm just going to skip by this. So if you are interested in our work, again, you'll find information on the Maynooth Green Campus page, but we do produce newsletters where we sort of collate all the things that we've done. So we usually have two per year, an autumn winter and a spring summer version. And the autumn winter one is we're just currently producing that now. So if you're interested in it, please look it up. And I just say again, thanks to the organizers, but I just want to leave on this slide here. So we're looking at Dr. Joe Larrigy and Dorina Bishop there. So they're the co-founders of the Maynooth Green Campus originally. And Joe retired this year, so he's no longer the chair of the Green Campus, and why I'm sitting here instead of him. But again, a lot of the ethos of the campus, or the Green Campus, a lot of our projects, the way we work, our rebellious nature, the as I said, the ethos in the group is basically because of the foundations that Joe put in place. So again, I just want to thank him for all the work. If you want to get in touch with us, again, you can find us on Twitter, Facebook and Instagram, or just email us directly at greencampus@mu.ie. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Jim. That was so insightful, and I'm sure Joe will be delighted that you're now the chair and taking over from him. And I'm sure he's also making inputs, and he's probably listening and going, ah, pick him up on that or this, or say thanks. Either way, wonderful to have you on board. So next, without delay, we have our wonderful Bridget Lachlan from Kildare County Council, who's going to talk to you about heritage and biodiversity. Bridget, you're mute.
That's never a good thing. Am I sharing yet? No. No.
Nope. You are now. Thank you.
For some reason I'm not seeing it. Which is never a good thing either. Okay, can I stop sharing again and just try again? Sorry.
Yeah. We can suggest that we can see it anyway. So, yeah.
Otherwise, I'd be looking at you at the side of my eye here. Can you see that, or am I in the middle of it?
You are in the center of it, but
how's that?
Perfect. That's perfect now.
Okay, bear with me. Okay. For some reason, it's appearing on my second screen. So if I turn my right ear to you, I'm not being discourteous. I'm just following my slides. Okay. Right. My brief for today, I suppose, is to give you a flavour of some of the things we in the Heritage Department, which I like to call myself, have been doing for biodiversity for the last number of years. Okay. I'm going to cover a few areas, and I'm going to cover them quite quickly. And one of the things Paula was very adamant that I would say is talk about what we have to do next. So what are we going to do next in Kildare? So that's part of what I'm hoping to cover. Okay. I'll give you some introduction to where the document that tells me what I do every day, which is the heritage plan. Some of our local biodiversity action plan projects, and I see Carl and Brian from Leader here, so I have to remember to thank them for their sponsorship of this project. Some habitat mapping in Kildare, something that we've been kind of piloting for the last couple of years in Kildare. Can you pilot for a couple of years? But anyhow, and then our action plan, a wetland survey, grant scheme, and I'll end with the more difficult of all of them, the planning policy. Okay. So first of all, we're on our second county heritage plan. The plan consists of one aim, four strategic objectives and 81 actions. I started out with this plan saying it wasn't going to have any more than 50, but that never goes like that. And partly because the people of Kildare are so interested in their heritage and have such great ideas around heritage. The heritage plan, you're probably wondering, why are we talking about a heritage plan and not a biodiversity plan? Well, the reason I'm talking about a heritage plan, not a biodiversity plan, is first of all, our biodiversity plan is out of date and it's due to be reviewed the end of this year. But more importantly, as a heritage officer, I view biodiversity, natural heritage and archaeological heritage in the round. So when I go out to a site of a graveyard, for example, I'm not just looking at the old church that's falling down or the headstones. I'm looking at the lichen on the headstone. I'm looking at the wildflower area that managed to not be cut. I'm looking at the yew trees and some of the more mature species. And then if I have time, I'll be looking at other things. But I suppose I view biodiversity as part of our heritage and part of every site that I visit. So I'm a nightmare when I'm brought to meetings in the council because I have a problem with most of what's been done. But just in terms of our strategic objectives, the first thing is a fairly obvious one. It's about raising awareness and telling people what's there. I'm from Kildare and I have to say, now looking back, I did not know my county when I started working in the council. And that's one of the joys of my job has been learning about Kildare's heritage. In fact, people said to me, sure, what heritage has Kildare? And one of the things about Kildare's heritage, no, we don't have a coastline. No, we don't have mountains. But yes, we do have bogs. And as Tristan and Lorraine and Jesmyn mentioned, they're a very important part of our landscape. But we have other heritage and certainly biodiversity that people are not aware of. So raising awareness, telling people what's there, trying to promote best conservation practice, getting information about heritage out to a wider audience and promoting heritage as a resource that contributes to the quality of life and culture and economic development of the county. And that applies obviously to biodiversity as much as anything else. So I'm not going to go through the plan, you'll be happy to hear. I'm just going to give you a sample of some of the actions. So the first one would be supporting community groups and NGOs in their community-led heritage projects that will help me do my work or help me meet the objectives of the plan. Another one, and we do that through our community grant scheme, which I'll tell you about in a moment. We've managed to fund, actually, I'll come to that in a second. Action two then is supporting local heritage initiatives through the grant scheme, as I said. Action 72 then is to develop a heritage awareness program, seminars, walks, talks, Heritage Week, Biodiversity Week, Culture Night. And then action 14 is to support the promotion and involvement of citizen science, which encourages the recording of wildlife and biodiversity for submission to the National Biodiversity Data Centre. And that's something that we support groups across the county to do. So that's just a sample of our actions in our heritage plan. So that's the document that whenever I want to do something, whenever I want to look for funding or whenever I need to try and do something, I have to find where it says it in my heritage plan. So an example of the heritage plan in action then would be this project. And this is the Kildare Local Biodiversity Action Plan project. It was an action in the County Kildare Heritage Plan. So it's action 15 and action 65. So action 15 is preparing these plans. Action 65 then is identifying local biodiversity important sites and integrating the findings into the county development plan. And I'll talk a little bit more about that particular action in a moment. But it's also action 15 in our climate adaptation strategy, which so means I'm doing Paula's work for her. I'm joking. This is a sample of one of our biodiversity plans here. Okay, so this project, I went to Carl and I didn't go to Carl, I went to the evaluation committee and discussed this as a project that I thought Leader would be very jumping up and down to support, and they were. So basically Leader funded this for me, but what we did was we, pre-COVID, all of this was happening pre-COVID, we identified 10 towns across the county, or the towns nominated themselves, and we selected 10 towns across the county to carry out biodiversity plans. And part of the project was, well, the important part of the project was not just to get the plan drawn up, but it was more to educate people and involve people in the preparation of the plan and bring them on the journey with us. And we had great plans about going out and visiting sites and having lovely walks around the towns. I was going to be spending my Saturdays walking around villages in Kildare and my evenings having cups of tea in town halls. Now, mind you, I spent, as did Maeve, we spent our evenings sitting in my back bedroom learning about biodiversity. But we did manage to do 10 plans all online, believe it or not. And I said to the consultants that took it on, they took on the challenge of climate change. We had hoped to finish it in July. It didn't finish until November because of climate change. But basically, the plan was to identify what's out there in the town, to map them, and then to come up with actions that could be carried out by these groups. It wasn't just Tidy Towns groups, it was all groups in the town. So you'll see some of the, when I get to some of the actions, that we engaged with the GAA, we engaged with businesses. I didn't write the actions. I had absolutely nothing to do with the actions that ended up in the plan. The actions came from the groups themselves. So some of the actions are very ambitious in some of the plans, and some of the actions are possibly not as ambitious, but very ambitious for that particular group. And this is something, it's a 5-year plan, and it's something that we can look at in 5 years' time and see what was carried out. I think I got hit everything there. Oh yeah, one of the other parts of the project was that there was biodiversity training as part of it. So the theme, now the plans themselves look quite similar because we kind of kept the same format throughout. So we had 4 main objectives. 1 was looking at making the town more wildlife friendly, 2 raising awareness, 3 gathering evidence, and 4 building capacity among the groups. So teaching people how to manage sites, how to plant a hedge, how to convince someone that not cutting the grass is a good idea, and maybe not using pesticides. So to build that capacity within the groups. So just things, this is Selbridge's, I picked Selbridge's biodiversity plan. And so the first objective there is making Selbridge biodiversity friendly. So here's a sample of some of the actions. I'm not going to read them, you're well able to read them yourself, but this is an example. They're very practical actions, okay? And as you can see, just the last one then was working with the football clubs in the town and the athletic clubs. Number 2 then is the raising of awareness. So again, sample of the actions, no invasive planting species in the town, encouraging the green club, involvement in the green club, and to run some biodiversity events. There's nothing complicated about these actions, but it was good to put them all in one place and have people discuss them. Carry out a tree survey, record your findings in MEDC. And then the most important action, I think, in the plan was to set up a committee to make sure this happens, and then to sit down after a period of time and say, well, did it happen? And if not, why didn't it happen? And I know Mary Jennings from Maynooth Tidy Towns is online. And Mary has been asking me to look at Maynooth again. And she's already identified some of the problems because Maynooth were one of the first towns to do a biodiversity action plan years ago. And Mary, I'll be in touch with you in the near future. The 4th objective then is to build local capacity. So again, how do you manage your volunteer, put together a volunteer list, hold events to talk about what you're doing. There's not much point in you planting, that lovely new word for an edible hedge, which my mother calls a farm hedge, and not telling people why you're not putting in the laurel or why you're not putting in a beech hedge. So tell them what you're doing. And one very easy action is to go to the local library and check that there's a stock of biodiversity resources in your local library. So they're the sample of the actions, and these are the 10 plans that were finalised in January of this year. Okay, just in terms of progress, just a few snapshots in terms of progress to date. In January 2021, as a result of this project, 12,270 trees were planted across the county. OK, and this was it's just an outcome of the project as the project was being kind of carried out. We had 10 biodiversity projects then. We secured funding from the elected representatives for a small grant scheme in November, so the 10 towns could enter a small scheme just limited to themselves, and they had to come up with 10 projects that were within their biodiversity plan, which they all have done, and they were carried out at the end of the year and the beginning of this year. And then the next steps, Paula, where are we going next? Where we're going next then is the elected representatives have agreed under the local property tax to fund another 10 plans. So 10 plans, there's another 10 towns that will have 10 plans done probably by March of this year, we'd have them finished. We'll be kicking off in the next couple of months. And one of the things, and this is Mary, this is a nod to Mary Jennings, because Mary was very adamant that this was needed. We hope to develop a mentoring system with an ecologist to work with these tidy towns and the other previous towns, and then and the other two towns that have went up and did their own plan. So we hope to have about 24 towns by next March that have their own biodiversity plan. Okay. So that's the first thing. Another project then that we've been actively engaged in Kildare, and apologies, Mary, for Mary O'Connor, this is Kildare Town. It's an old map. It was one of the first towns we did this in. We've heard about the importance of our natural and our semi-natural areas and the fact that they are being lost. People may or may not be aware that natural heritage sites, there's only two levels of protection. And one of them is the SAC and NHA, which are the European sites that are designated, and they're protected by European laws. It's quite a strong protection. However, that is only for a very small, narrow number of habitats and a very small, narrow number of species. And they are species that where Ireland is very, very important globally for these. We also have our NHAs, but our NHAs have never been fully designated. But in Kildare, we have something like 30, I think it's about 30 NHAs. They are the only habitats in the country that are actually protected, that are safe from some level of development or removal. So that's the point about the very little legal protection. You're all familiar with the weak legislation around our hedgerows and our trees. So you can imagine people always say, why isn't there a law for this? But I actually believe that people knowing what's there and valuing it is a hell of a lot more. Have a lot stronger in protecting things than telling people they can't do it. So this is part of what this project is about. We carried out habitat mapping in Kildare Town in advance of the local area plan for Kildare, and it identified the different types of habitats in the town. And actually, I'm just linking back there to Action 65 of the Heritage Plan. This is how I managed to be able to get the funding for this. So what we ended up then with was a green infrastructure network in Kildare Town. OK, so these funny colours here are basically a linking of the network. Now, this is one of the very first ones we did. We've actually moved on a lot more since then. And if any of you take a look at the two most recent plans adopted at Thai and Nace, we've now gone a step further and we've actually identified trees and hedgerows and wet areas to be retained, not to be removed. OK, it's our attempt at trying to protect this urban biodiversity. And it's actually beginning to prove to produce results. It's in its early stages for us in Kildare and our County Kildare. Kildare was one of the first towns we did it. And we learn as each plan goes along and we add a little bit more to it. So each local area plan now, as a matter of course, will have a green infrastructure network map as part. And that is relatively recent. OK, we also then have town specific policies. We used to have town specific policies. Now we have hedgerow specific policies. So we were very brave in a Thai and Nace, and we actually, as I said, identified hedges to be kept. Now, we'll have to see how that pans out in terms of development. OK, another action that we were involved in Kildare is our Kildare Pollinator Action Plan. And we were asked to sign up as a partner in the All-Ireland Pollinator Plan, as a lot of local authorities were. And we were asked quite early. And I have to say, I kind of said, well, yeah, hold on. There's no point in just signing up and then not knowing what does that entail for us as a local authority. So I used that as an opportunity to engage with all the service departments. I didn't put the slide in. To engage with all the service departments. So from corporate to community, libraries, roads, water, parks, all across the local authority. Mary O'Connor actually was commissioned to carry out this research. We sat down with all of the staff, and the first question was, Mary gave them an introduction to the pollinator plan and the biodiversity crisis, and then she asked them, well, what are you doing already? Because we were very aware that a lot of the service departments were already doing things that were of benefit to the pollinators, but weren't recorded. So that was our first step. What are you doing? And then what can you do? So right, we now have a document that was adopted in the middle of COVID, last year, which seems like years ago now, but it was in the middle of COVID, County Kildare's pollinator plan. And it has a series and quite a number of actions right across the organisation for things to do for pollinators. That's pretty much it. And we also then, when we had the plan, it was adopted by the Cathaoirleach, and then it was, we actually then signed up as a partner. I felt it was important that we had a plan before we signed up to something. So these are just the goals. Mary identified eight goals of the plan. So I'm not going to go through them all there. You can read them. And if you want to look at the pollinator plan, it's actually online. So look it up for yourselves. But just an example of some of the actions that we would sign up as a partner. So that was the corporate action. The planning action was that all new local area plans would include objectives on pollinators and habitats and where it was appropriate to do so. The Parks Department, that they would look at reducing the amount of pesticides. This is just a sample. There's more than one action per service area. I'm just pulling them out. That the Facilities Department would start managing our grounds in a more pollinator friendly way, hopefully similar to what they're doing over in Maynooth. In our environment section, that the habitat mapping and hedger conservation management would happen at Cilliat Hill, and that has happened. And then in our water services, that all of the wastewater treatment plant, that we would conduct a survey of what's happening there. Wastewater treatment plants are turning out to be little oases of biodiversity in the landscape, because they're water treatment plants, they cannot use pesticides or herbicides in close to the plant. So actually these are hugely biodiverse areas. So one of our actions is to maybe start surveying these and find out exactly what is there. Okay. So another one of our projects, which we did a number of years ago and is I'm getting to use it now, is we did a survey of Kildare wetlands over 3 years, and we identified a number of sites across the county. I have it here. We identified 12 of our internationally important sites, and I think Ballydermot is included in that, so I need to double check that. 33 of our nationally important sites and 20 county important sites and 62 of high value and locally important. Now, one of the reasons I did this was for a couple of reasons. One, there was a change to the planning legislation and a required developments of over 0.1 hectare, which is quite small. If somebody was filling in a drain or reclaiming wetland of that area, they are required to have planning. And I thought, that's grand, but how are the planners going to know where these are? So that was one of the reasons. So we now have a layer on our planning system of our wetlands in the county. And this year, hopefully, we'll be able to identify policies and objectives to support the protection of those wetlands. That's what I'm aiming for in the county development plan, and I'll talk more about that in a moment. So we have identified them, we know where they are, and we know which are the really good ones, another project then is our Community Heritage Grant Scheme. And this is a project that's now been running for, I think, 11 years. And under this scheme, we funded 471 projects that have something to do with heritage. They're not all biodiversity, but they're heritage. And the average grant that they receive is about €1,000. So that's 471,000 over the last 11 years that have gone towards heritage, which I think I have to say, and fair dues to the elected representatives who agree this every year in the budget when we go to them looking for this funding. I'm not going to go through the projects there, but there's a sample of the types of projects that we fund, the biodiversity projects. We have other projects. If you're interested in more detail on those projects, we have a sample of the project reports. You have to do, if you get funding from us under this grant scheme, as Tristan will know, you have to do a project report at the end of the year and tell us how the money was spent and what you found. So those reports are there if anybody wants to have a look at them. Okay, the part that I find really interesting is the whole idea of planning policy and the county development plan. For those of you that are not aware, we are currently reviewing our county development plan. The planners are hard at work beavering away, and we hope to have a draft plan, if adopted by the members, out in early of next year. Okay, so in the county development plan, you may or may not be aware, there is a requirement under law to include policies and objectives around the conservation and protection of environment, in particular archaeology and natural heritage, and the conservation and protection of European sites and any other sites which may be prescribed for the purposes of this paragraph. It's very legal. Or the encouragement to pursue to Article 10 of the Habitats Directive of the management of features of the landscapes as traditional field boundaries, important for the ecological coherence of the Natura 2000 network and essential for the migration, dispersal and genetic exchange of wild species. Basically, as far as I'm concerned, that is our hedgerows and our urban, our biodiversity that exists within our habitats that exist within the landscape that are not protected, to try and keep that connectivity. Okay, so that's what we have to do. We have to include policies on that area. So chapter 13, for some reason, is always the natural heritage chapter in the development plan. And our title is Natural Heritage, Biodiversity and Green Infrastructure. So we have a number of policies and objectives, and I didn't count them, but quite a number on these topics. So one, the first one is the designated sites. We have to have policies on the SACs and NHAs. We've introduced a policy this year on county biodiversity sites. So one of the things I'm hoping to do, if this policy makes it through to the final plan and is adopted by the members, is to start looking at mapping those locally important sites. One of the things I've realised in my time as a heritage officer, that while we don't have legislation to protect biodiversity in the county, if we can get it listed in the local area plan or the county development plan, there is a chance that it will be considered early in planning applications and therefore is protected. So up until now, we've managed to include our geological heritage sites, even though there's no legislation to protect them in this country. And this year, we're hoping to include our wetlands. And I'm hoping to work my way through all of the other sites and to start including them. But I also want to start identifying our county biodiversity sites. We have policies on trees and woodlands, inland waterways, lakes, rivers, streams, groundwater. We've a new policy area this year on riparian zones, and it's following the IFI guidelines on setbacks from rivers. We have inland water, policy on inland waters, so that's our canals for Cork, wetlands and Ramsar sites, invasive species, geology, and then we have a whole section on green infrastructure. So I would encourage you, when the draft plan comes out, for you to have a look at those policies, and if you don't think they go strong enough, to make a submission when you can and ask for additional policies or stronger policies, and then they will be considered by the planners. A recommendation will then be made, a manager's report it's called, is made. The planners will make recommendations, and then it will go to your elected representatives to agree or disagree with the planners' recommendations. That's the process. Very democratic. Okay, so what's next for Kildare? This is for Paula. Okay. I would hope this year to be doing to be starting our County Kildare Biodiversity Action Plan, probably quarter three or quarter four of next year. I will be carrying out the actions in the County Kildare Heritage Plan that have a biodiversity focus. We will be continuing with our urban habitat mapping. And Peter, you asked the question, what about Maynooth? We are doing it, and we're updating the habitat mapping for Maynooth, and we will be extending it into new areas. So that will be hopefully going into the plan. One of the actions in the actions in the new county development plan is a green infrastructure strategy for Kildare. So hopefully in the coming years, we will be looking at that. Not many of them have been done in Ireland, so it's something we'll be looking at. The local biodiversity action programme, I've already mentioned that we're extending it to another 10 towns this year. I carry out training for community groups, for staff in the council on biodiversity, but also I hope to expand the biodiversity network next year, working with the groups around the county, developing that county biodiversity network of sites, also mapping other resources in the county and trying to come up with ways of protecting them, be it through planning or be it through raising awareness. And I suppose to finish, I'd like to continue to mainstream biodiversity across the local authority, that it's something that is considered whenever we do any kind of a project, that biodiversity is one of the things that's considered at the start. Thank you.
Bridget, take a deep breath there. Very well done. Folks, next we have our final presentation of the evening. Bridget, you must be exhausted, which is going to be a video that we made when we're on the wonderful farm belonging to the McCalls. So just give us a second and we'll have that uploaded. We're going to have a short session after that then of Q&A, because we won't have as much time as we had, but I think everybody's happy enough for that, because I think the presentations were fantastic and gave people an awful lot of information. And then we'll work from there. Just give us a second, folks, it's just loading up, okay?
My name's Kim McCall. I farm quite a large farm in Kildare. It's 214 acres. It's a mixed grazing farm, and we have a mix of cattle, suckler cows and sheep, with about 25 acres of forestry, and it's mainly oak, beech, ash, and a wee bit of Sitka spruce and Norway spruce. And then throughout the farm, there are tree lines, hedge lines, and it is run in an environmentally sensitive way. We use no artificial fertilizer. I'm not organic, but we don't use any sprays or herbicides, because I find that, you know, you have to read the instructions, and if you don't read the instructions, you get it wrong. So it's easier not to use them at all. And it actually is a far more exciting way to farm. Over the farm from my dad in 1986, when he had horses, we kept horses for another few years, and then we changed over to sucklers and sheep. And as I said, we changed over to being from an unconventional farmer to a very unconventional organic farmer. Protecting farmland pollinators, and it started in 2019 and will run to 2023. That scheme entails, first of all, in the first year or year and a half, it entailed the Biodiversity Centre coming out, and they assessed the farms. They did a survey of the plants and the fauna and flora on the farms, and then they actually put up traps, various types of traps, be they trade traps or malaise traps. They had malaise traps and trade traps, and they collected insects three to five times on certain farms, and I know they did it on five times on this farm. And we haven't got records back yet of what insects were there, but I know there was an awful lot. Benefits of the scheme probably is going to be information and knowledge and education of the 40 farmers that are in the scheme. And I think judging we're in a WhatsApp group, judging by some of the comments, I mean, people have suddenly realized, oh, there's a bee, there's a bumblebee, there's a hoverfly, or there's butterflies. I always knew they were there, but never really noticed them. And it's just, you know, it's a waking up. And I think that will be the best thing that's come out of this EIP. And it will fulfill what it needs to do, which is counter the insects. And we'll know what's on these farms, from the what I call chemical alley farms to really organic farms. And we have everything in between. And I think it's important to know, because, you know, if those farms that use a lot of pesticides still have wildlife, obviously they're still doing something right. You get paid, and it's on a sliding scale. It's like it comes from the scorecard. So if you get a very high score, then you get, I think the maximum payment is $4,000, and it can go all the way down to as good as zero. But most farmers will get a reasonable amount. You have to have a farm of, I think, a minimum of 50 acres, and you have to be willing to participate, for one, and do what's asked of you. You don't have to change your farming system, but you have to put up, say, some bee hotels, very small bee hotels, and do some scrapes on the banks, say, and bear the vegetation, so you get clean earth, so that the bees could use them as nesting habitats. That's your only criteria, and you can farm as you wish. This is a very interesting little plot. It's something I started 7 years ago, which was way before the EIP came along. And it's the wettest piece of ground in this field. It was, you know, you couldn't walk through it. You needed high boots rather than just normal boots. And I decided to fence it off, so I don't let the cows graze this over the summertime. And the first year or so didn't see much difference, but from year two onwards, I noticed that the rushes were actually not as dominant as they used to be. And actually standing in it at the moment, it's quite hard to see a rush. And that's from the natural competition from all the other grasses and herbs, vetches, broadleaf plants. There's no nettles, there's no docks, there's very few thistles in this. It's mainly what you'd call very interesting flora. And in the summertime, it's full of insects. There's newts in this, there's frogs in it, there's loads of different butterflies in it. And I think it's an interesting piece of ground in that if this was enlarged, it could be an interesting part of changing grazing strategy to actually get, not so much get rid of rushes, but to actually keep rushes under control. Because either side of this, I have summer grazing and the rushes are doing very nicely, thank you. But in this area, which is only small, it's about half an acre, it's hard to see the rushes at all. And that's just changing grazing strategy from summer grazing to winter grazing. But it made me very aware of what I have, and we're always learning. I mean, 5 years ago, I asked me what type of bumblebees we had on the farm. No idea. And I think it's through this and other forms of education that we've all had over the last 5 years, be it in biofarm and knots through knots, we've all learned a lot what's on our farms, and I think it's really time that we all appreciate what's there, because it might be there in the future unless we do something. Absolutely no specialized equipment necessary. Only most important piece of equipment to have is a spade. And then with the spade, you can take the vegetation off the bank, allow the bees to colonize that bank. And I would say put the sprayer away and buy yourself a good spade. Really educating me and all the other farmers of what is possible to farm environmentally, and whether you want to or not is probably eventually going to be compulsory. So we might as well learn now when it's voluntary, and we can be ahead of the posse, and we can be educated, and really to do it, it doesn't alter productivity in the slightest, whether you cut a hedge this year or next year. It certainly in stock farms makes zero difference. In tillage farms, you know, I'm not a tillage farmer, so you probably have to ask one of them. But certainly stock farms, the shelter that you'll get from the hedge, and I have left hedges now uncut for the last 30 years, and I haven't been meeting them halfway across the fields. We have to, through the scheme, we were assessed the first year by the biodiversity itself, Biodiversity Centre itself. And this year and subsequent years, we assess ourselves. So if we have, say, improved something or put in a hedge, or some may have taken hedges out, that is all to go back down in your scorecard and you will be judged as such. So if you've improved your farm, putting in wildflower strips from native seed sources, left hedges uncut, let hay fields grow or silage fields grow till the flowers have actually flowered, gone through their life cycle, then that will go down your scorecard as an improvement, and you will be paid accordingly. And if you've, say, sprayed fields and planted with a monoculture ryegrass, well then, you know, that's a detraction. And I think we have to get away from monoculture of all sorts, and that includes forestry as well, because we're all seeing from the amount of disease that is coming in that the minute you have a monoculture, then we're all screaming for handouts and compensation. Whereas if you put in diverse species, you know, you've got droughts and you'll get floods and you get all sorts of other hiccups. But the pasture will still survive. This farm is all old pasture. Nothing's reseeded. I think the youngest field's 50 years old in seeding, and I doubt there was probably very much of that left. And the productivity is exactly the same. I'm not a dairy farmer, a suckler farmer, and I feel I have the right breed that suits the farm, and I have the right breed that suits me. The scheme will have no derisory impact whatsoever, and I think it's an enhancement, and I think it needs to go forward to the greater part of farming, because we need to be more aware of what we got on the farms and appreciate what we have, because once it's lost, it's very hard to bring back. And I think if you can appreciate what's there, you'll be one step ahead of people that have dug themselves in and are still trying to take things out to produce most from most. I think we need to be the middle ground. We need to be able to produce sustainably and with resilience, as we've shown over the last 3 or 4 years between floods and droughts. People have been up to their collar in trying to produce food. And I don't think production of food is a problem. It's how the production is done. And as a planet, we're producing more than enough food for the people that are on it. And we're producing more than enough food for the 10 billion people that can be on it. But we need to do that I think sustainability is a load of nonsense. It needs to be resilient. Wholeheartedly, I think you have to get off the bandwagon of buying stuff. You need to be producing stuff. As one of the smart American farmers said, you want to be signing the back of the check, not the front. Just to say that this type of farming is much more exciting than conventional farming, because you're a pioneer. You're actually working things out. You're making mistakes, but you can learn from the mistakes, and they're generally not that costly. And it's the way that farming will go. And I think small is going to be the answer, not big. I think I heard at the top of the crash, not this last crash, but the first one, that we need 3 or 4 big ideas for the country. And I thought to myself, no, we need 4 million small ideas.
So folks, that's the end of the video. And I think you can all agree it's a great insight to what's possible in farming. Now, I know we've only got literally 14 minutes left, because I'm sure people want to see the next generation's video at 5 o'clock. So I'm just going to, first of all, just ask everybody one question. I'm going to start with Kim and Mirielle, if that's okay, because we get to hear from them as such. So if I just want to know, guys, for yourselves, given that you're in the EIP, can you briefly explain the hedgerows you have on your farm, their use and the habitat role for the pollinators? Kim, you're on mute. Hold on, Kim, I'll try and unmute you there. Give me 1 second.
Sorry about that.
You're okay. Go ahead.
The amount of hedgerows we have on the farm, we've probably got over 12 kilometres. Some people would call them tree lines. Some people call them hedgerows. I find them, they have multiple benefits in that they shelter the farm. They enhance the farm with biodiversity, be it birds, insects, amphibians, you name it, you can throw your hat at them. There's bats, there's mammals, and it just enhances the farm for the farmer, not only the environment. It basically farms, the most important person on the farm is the farmer. And after that, once he's aware or she's aware, then that's you're on the ball to really start going places. Paul is mute now.
Paula, you're on mute.
Apologies, guys. Apologies. There's too many buttons at the moment. Bridget, you're next. So we got some questions thrown at us by the public before we started today. So I just want you to possibly give an answer to these two, if you could, Bridget. Mm-hmm. Can you explain what the Climate Action Team is and its importance to the public? And given your passion about the subject, what is the one thing you would ask people to do to support biodiversity?
Okay, I'm a member of the Climate Action Team, and I have to say our director, the director over Climate Action Team, Joe Boland, was very visionary when he put the team together. He went around to all of the service departments and asked them to send somebody along. And he was very adamant that this plan would be prepared by the Climate Action Team. So we have staff from the Roads Department, Water Services, the Fire Service, the Libraries, Community, Planning, I'm there, Paul is there. So there's quite a diverse, we've actually, it's a large team, and we can have great debates and arguments when we're trying to put stuff together. But we do work well, and what's really good about having a team like that is, well, this is what we're supposed to do, and Paul is the one that checks that we do this. We're supposed to bring the climate action back to our service department and ensure that it's top of the agenda and the first thing that's considered. That can be a challenge, but it's great to have a plan behind us and have the climate action team behind us to enable us to do that. You know, so as Paula will say, and it's something we in positions like this, we always say we're trying to mainstream it, and it's beginning to sink in. So that's who we are. And what was the second question?
Given your passion for the subject, what's the one thing you would ask people to do?
The one thing I think, and this applies to industry, applies to everybody, is stop tidying the place up. OK, just let things grow. Put down the pesticides. Just let things grow. I was lucky enough to grow up on a farm, and I was surrounded by fields and hedgerows and trees and everything. So it's something that I'm very familiar with. And I don't know about Kim's farm, but our farm wasn't always the tidiest of farms. So there's always places where things were grown. So you knew that. But we seem to have moved into a time where our new normal is everything is tidy and everything is neat. And people, wildlife is over there and the pretty flowers are over here and everything is in its place. And there's a generation of people growing up, maybe not the next generation, but certainly my generation or the generation after me, where everything has to be neat and tidy. And we've started a whole program, as I'm sure you've been aware of, trying to reduce pesticide use across the county. But we're beginning to get pushback from people who hark back to the days of tidiness. And I remember when I started years and years ago, I had a lecturer who was lecturing me on grassland. My primary degree is agriculture science, so I once was an agriculture advisor, but he was advising me on weed species in grassland. And somebody put their hand up and said, is it really a weed or is it just a flower that's underappreciated or in a place that it's not really wanted? So my lesson for everybody would be, let the place go a little bit wild. Stop trying to tidy everything up. And you'll be interested to see how people will get really interested in what they can see in your wild spaces. One of the interesting things for the Parks Department, I think Paula will agree, are even the estates that we support in not cutting their grass is more children are playing on the green areas. In the past, the grass was cut so tight, there was a perception you can't go near that place, don't walk on the grass. We all grew up with those signs. Whereas now children are actually going on to the wetland area, the wet areas. So my one piece of advice is stop being so tidy.
Jim, you're up next. The can-do attitude in Maynooth campus, how do you think we can bring that from the campus to the wider area of the County of Kildare?
It's a good question. I suppose show the results of your success. I think that's the key thing, is when you do a project, make sure it's well publicised, make sure people see it, make sure the benefits are recorded, that you have the evidence. Link it in with places like the National Biodiversity Data Centre, be open to collaboration, work with people. I think that's really the key to it all. So the more people that become exposed to initiatives and projects, even if it is like Bridget is saying about sort of, you know, letting places go a little bit rewild, there has to be some information with it. There has to be connection to it. There has to be ownership of it. So if that's in a community, you have to explain to the community why it's important that it's happening. There's a great, someone mentioned it earlier on in that first set of talks about the local community around the Lullymore and all, you know, having confidence. I think that's great, because again, it's you need to give the communities ownership of these types of projects and initiatives. So what I was saying at the start of just answering the question, it's about exposing people to the benefits of what you're trying to do, not just doing them for and not sort of following through. Another key thing of the success is engaging with children. I think that's absolutely key. And again, you see this through the All-Ireland Pollinator Plan. And I actually think a lot of our ethos in the Green Campus comes from the All-Ireland Pollinator Plan as well, in terms of provide the information in packages that are digestible to different sectors. So, and again, with school children, we have programs in our Frebel department that have these tree trails that have designed activities and learning programs for primary school teachers to basically get children out into nature, go on these walks, see some folklore. They can look at, you know, information online and find out about folklore of various trees and that. But then those children bring it home, and that's really where we need to focus on.
Thanks, Jim. Really appreciate that. Great answer. Next one, of course, is for our National Peatlands Park Group. So whoever can answer these as we go. The questions were asked prior to this session have been answered, so I'm going to give you as words that came in while you were on. So the scope of the National Park may be expanded to include the Curra, Pollistown Fen and Milltown Feeder Canal to link to the greater ecological landscape. That came in from Mary O'Connor, I think. Good suggestion. I take it that you agree with that, but you can tell me a second. But the next thing is, somebody said, Anne, a wonderful presentation, beautiful photographs. What is the status of the project, please?
Okay, maybe I'll start off and my colleagues can chip in if they want. First of all, on including broadening the scope of the National Peatlands Park to include other areas, we're not just talking, a national park can have separate bits in all parts of the county. And what we'd like to do is create linkages between these wealth of areas that we have of high nature value in the county, but centred around the nucleus of Lullymore, which has all that infrastructure, as you said, Jim. Where are we in the proposal? Well, we are much further on than we were about 6 months ago. We have been going around community groups, to the County Council itself, the strategic policy committees. We've had a meeting with Board Nimona. We were in touch with the department, the NPWS, who will have overall responsibility for implementing this. A national park has that title, national, so it has to be government. We're encouraged to see that Malcolm Noonan is hiring 50 more, not necessarily ecologists, but wildlife wardens to around the country. So we're hoping that some of those will be designated for Kildare. So it's a multi-stranded approach that we have. We hope also to see it in the County Development Plan. As this will be very important to signpost everything that Bridget was talking about mapping wetlands, everything. Let's just put it into our plan, and that will give visibility to the project and celebrate our biodiversity heritage in a very real way. I think that's it. Yeah. Do any of my colleagues want to chip in there? Tris, Jesmond, Ray.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with all of that. And as we say, there's just because our proposal is centred on the Ballydermot Bog Group region, there's absolutely no resistance on our part. In fact, enthusiasm on our part to draw in as many areas of the county into that as we can. I mean, there are fabulous habitats that are well outside that zone and deserve and need much better protection they're receiving at the moment, like Harristown Common, for example, which is an amazing place and hardly anybody ever knows about it or goes there or knows about it. So it's vital that all areas are protected. In promoting our national park proposal, we're not saying this is the only important bit of the county. We're not going near that at all. We're interested in all biodiversity, but it's the scale of the project that we are particularly emphasizing, because for various ecological reasons, habitats of scale are far better at protecting biodiversity long term than isolated sites.
Thank you so much, folks. Really appreciate your honesty there and all your feedback. We're approaching 2 minutes to 5, so I'm going to close this off. We could talk here all day long, I think, because we all have common interests in this area. Great to see you all, and any questions that haven't been answered, we'll do that and send them out to you later on. Is that okay? So that nobody's left behind, as it were. Last but not least, I have to say the can-do attitude that's out there is fantastic. The chatter between you all just showed what is liked about what every person was doing in each and every area. And we'd really, really like to thank you all so much for your time and for your communications on this. So if anybody's interested, at 5 o'clock, there is a video by the looking at the conversation on climate with the next generation. It's only half an hour. It's extremely good and it gives you a perspective of teenagers and what they think we should be doing. So please continue on your climate action out there, folks. Do everything that you're doing, keep doing it, and do more of it wherever you can, and we'll help you as, if at all possible. So say thank you again. Take care, folks, and we'll see you again soon.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Paula.
Bye bye.